take your seats. Thank you very much.
So I'd just like to say that we are continuing to provide services that are needed by our residents, and we are finding ways to make money that will enable us to deliver them. But it would be remiss of me, especially this time of year, to say that we also know on this borough we have a disproportionately high number of people who use food banks. I visited the Women's Refuge yesterday with a donation from one of my residents who had kindly donated her into fuel allowance despite the fact that she's over 80. She thought that the refuge deserves it more than her. And when I was in the refuge, it kind of really hit me just how many people we've got in this world that are so vulnerable and need our help so much. So I would just like to say to thank everyone who's worked on this. It's been a difficult process. It doesn't get any easier, it gets harder each year. But we've managed to hopefully present a budget here that we will deliver next year and we will balance those books. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Williamson. Any comments? Councillor Jones?
Thanks, Pat.
It relates to community wealth building, Janette. I know the city region are looking at us as an exemplar, but I'm also mindful of the proposed change in governance which we'll find ourselves in next year. And I'm a little concerned that our community wealth initiatives will end up getting lost within the melee of new committees. I suppose what I'm asking is, can we ensure that community wealth building initiative and all its associated parts, including the checks and balances associated with it, actually find a home that is predominantly financially based within our committee structure?
Thanks for having me. I agree. We have been to visit the combined authority last week to talk about what we're doing here on Wirral. And you're right, we are being held up as the exemplar. And we do get mentioned quite a bit around the country now at various community wealth building events. So I would be ensuring as much as I can that our community wealth building strategy is firmly embedded in the new system going forward and that we don't overlook it in the new community system.
Councillor Jones.
Yeah, thanks for that. And the other one really is a statement. I know, despite trillion budgets, the situation we found ourselves in with our flagship regeneration programmes and the spend that's been made available for those, it would be remiss of me leading that portfolio not to publicly thank you and the officers involved in finance for all the hard work and the dedicated spend on those particular initiatives. So thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Jones. Councillor Usher.
I just wanted to make a couple of comments on the budget. As the lead man of Children Services, it's my responsibility to highlight issues and concerns within my service area regarding to our responsibility for the children who are in our care. And it's appropriate for me to mention a number of things around about the budget. And I know that the festive holidays are just around the corner and it's when we all hopefully find a couple of days to retreat into our families and spend time with loved ones and take a break from the general crashes of life. And I'd just like to concentrate everyone's mind for a moment on just how far from reality that picture is of the festive season for many families in the borough. Over the last 10 years, we've seen a tsunami when it comes to family breakdown and people not being able to cope with the complex pressures of everyday life to the point whereby in a decade, the number of children in care in this country has doubled and we had the record society, which I believe is one of the most astounding facts, that 2017 was the year that we saw the most children came ever. It's one that should shame the incumbent government. Before 2010, we were much better at identifying and helping families early on because the resources were there. Successive governments have decimated budgets for early help and intervention services. These were services that could identify early risks developing within families and communities and deal with them before they were before they presented themselves at a crisis point. Because these services no longer exist, we are completely outpaced by demand. Without support, faced with rising bills, poor wages and job insecurity, more families are presenting themselves at crisis point now. At the point whereby we have seen social workers and our services having to intervene at the crisis point, at the statutory point, and take children into care. This has absolutely got everything to do with financial decisions that were made regarding the austerity agenda. Many people would argue that it makes financial sense when you've had a recession to cut costs. However, if you take an example of a cost in terms of how much it costs for a council to have a child in care for a week, this is a week, not a month or a year, £4,208 was the average cost in Somerset Council, for example. That's 1 week. Early intervention would be a fraction of a fraction of that cost. It's a complete economic falsehood that this model of financial decision making makes sense. It absolutely does not make sense. It costs more, and the human cost is absolutely staggering. When it comes to our own situation, we have approximately seen a £233 million cut from 2010, which has been the greatest financial challenge that we've seen since the council's inception. When you look at our looked after children rate, we've got an increase by the hundreds over a decade. In 2010, we had approximately 550 plus children in care. And at the high point in the last few years, this year, we had approximately 850 children in care. When you look at the staff headcount of the council, you have 7,669 staff in 2010. And we're now down to 3,730. Our capacity to be a leader in terms of positive change and positive services in our communities has been limited by successive government's decisions over finances. Despite this, we managed a number of years ago to make a £20 million investment in children's services, and actually in a relatively short space of time we went from being in intervention to being requires improvement with a number of elements that were rated good by Ofsted. When local councils are given adequate resources, they can deliver good quality services and they can be transformative in people's lives. We've managed to set a balanced budget again this year. Well, we're going out to consultation on a number of options, and it has been a struggle and an achievement for all around the table. But the fact that we have been decimated in terms of capacity. And that's one example in the near future of children's services and the fact that when it's funded properly, we can do better things for our communities and our people is a testament for the fact that local government needs to be funded properly in this country, and the current government should really take a long, hard look at the legacy of the Conservative Party and what it's done to local government, and especially protect services like children's services and adult services that deal with vulnerable people.
I don't agree with Tom on the first decisions I took as the new lead for finance was to invest an extra £20 million in children's, and you're right, sustained and increased austerity has both driven children, increased numbers of children through our doors and diminished our capacity to deal with that, and this government has to own that. It's happened on their watch. We've yet to see what the financial settlement will be with the new government. I just don't think they've broken some of their many election promises that they made, and that they finally recognise that local government is absolutely invaluable to residents, and particularly those that have their needs. So let's just see if they've got to put their money where their mouth is.
Set the legal budget which is balanced and still allows Wirral Council to continue to provide the vital services our residents rely upon has been more and more difficult, of course, every year since austerity has begun. As we've heard, the last decade has seen this authority stripped, as we've heard from Tom before, of more than £233 million. That's a reduction in spending power of more than a third, and it's primarily because of the amount of funding from central government has been cut by 52%. That's a tremendous amount of money, can you think of it, which is the point you were making, Councillor Usher, when you spoke. And of course, we've been given the task, have we not, in the coming year, with yet another £32 million provision taken out of our budget. And this is at a time when demand, obviously, as we've begun to repair in key services such as social care, is soaring, placing greater pressure, of course, on frontline services. However, even though some sound voices think otherwise, no one will be helped by us setting a legal budget, because obviously the government will simply step in and make those decisions for us without any regard for local priorities and needs, obviously. As a council, we have dug deep, have we not, and have been radically changing the way we work. We heard that, of course, with the local plan recently, and obviously we'll be giving an update on that at the coming council. And this will continue as we have to go further, obviously, to balance our books. Today, as I speak, just a few days before Christmas, the council's reserves, again, as we've heard, are at the lowest, Janette, for a decade only, and we've been forced to rely on them to bridge the gaps in funding, an option which we can no longer rely upon. But we have to do this because, by the government's own reckoning, Wirral's residents, one of the most deprived areas, is in our, based on analysis of income levels, employment, education, health, crime, and barriers to housing. We have a responsibility, of course, to our residents, who rely on the services this council provides, and despite diminishing central government funding, we are working hard to bring about the regeneration desperately needed in areas across the borough, not least in Liskard, New Ferry and Birkenhead, where we have huge, huge ambitions. Money and profits, of course, from the Birkenhead developments that will help us in later years bridge the gap of the money that will be taken from the vulnerable people who rely on the services that they have to say rely upon. Taken with no thought of the sick and defenceless people who will suffer as a result. Unless we see a sharp U-turn in government thinking. And we have heard, and we know from governments, that they are going to invest in the north. We'll believe it when we see it. We hope, against hope, that money will be invested in the north. They have said that in the last week. And you know, we need that to protect the people that we represent here in this borough and that we work upon. But you know, we wait with bated breath. The budget sets out how the council meets its obligations to ensure that the most vulnerable, as I say, will not be left behind and everyone will receive the services they expect. Now, if we look ahead to a new decade, we are committed to ensure that this council, obviously, is in a stable financial position, and I thank Councillor Gerr Williamson over the last number of years for helping to achieve that, and every cabinet member who's been around the table over that time. Obviously, to pursue our ambitions and bring regeneration and growth to the borough, as I've just said, and bring a prosperous 2020 that provides choices and opportunities for everyone. It will go through the usual process. Residents will be consulted upon the options before us and before them, and we'll go through scrutiny in January, and then it will come to Budget Council in early March. So I'm going to thank everybody for the comments and thank you all for your hard work. Okay, has there any more comments? No? Thank you. Okay, the next item on the agenda. Sorry, I do apologise. Can we formally move? I'll move. Councillor Jenner, you can move the budget.
So
yeah, I'll second it. Can we agree? Okay, number five, Tranmere Rovers request for financial assistance. That's Councillor Jenner Williamson again.
Okay, thanks, Pat. Well, okay, so this is the second and last report from me for today, this year, actually, and it's quite nice. Refreshing to have something positive here to talk about. So this is around the financial assistance that our local football club, Tranmere Rovers, has requested from us as a council. So using the unique power of football, Wirral Council is set to begin working ever closer with Tranmere Rovers to help those at risk of social isolation. Whether through poverty, unemployment, mental or physical health issues, the council and the football club aim to work closer to help those who are struggling. So the move follows on from an agreement in September between Wirral Council and Tranmere Rovers to enter a formal partnership to work together. Previously, the work carried out by Tranmere was dispersed across the council. The establishment of a partnering agreement set out the council's ambition to bring this work with the club together and recognise their contribution to community activities and programmes to support vulnerable people carried out on behalf of the local authority. The project will involve improvements to the Park Rec Centre, allowing the club to enhance the services and programmes it provides to the local community in partnering with the council. Currently, the Rec Centre offers various community and educational programmes, as well as being the base of Tranmere Rovers in the community, education services and the hub for the international business and cultural exchange. Existing facilities include the full-size multi-sport hard courts, a community cafe, a gym, four classrooms and two social suites. More than 350 people pay a week benefit from the facility, from dementia-friendly social groups with the elderly and their carers, and the National Citizen Service Programme, to after-school homework clubs and holiday activities, adult learning courses, and NHS use of community gym for weight management, and a wide range of other activities. This is, for me, this sums up community focus that this local authority has in our work, joint work at Tranmere Rovers. I think they're a fantastic community focused club. They deliver really brilliant projects to our most vulnerable and I was really, really pleased to announce this, and I'll hold it up for Tranmere Rovers as well, I have to say, as coming from a family who are season ticket holders.
Thank you, Councillor Williamson. Councillor Jones.
Thank you, Pat. I'd just like to support Janette really in this fantastic project partnership. Tranmere Rovers, Public Health already do commission some services, but the rest of the stuff they do, I think if you just look at the list in 3.7, you know, they're talking about children from the age of 3 up to 18. And I think football plays such a huge part in people's lives on Merseyside, even on rugby fans now. But I think, you know, the work they do around people's health and well-being is fantastic, and I totally agree that we should do this.
Councillor Tony Jones.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. With regard to the partnering agreement, Janette, I think we would be looking at the list that's contained within the report. I think we have an opportunity as well to ask Tranmere Rovers if they could consider, in partnership with the North West Ambulance Service, if they could consider introducing defibrillator training and basic CPR. The quick calculation I did on the back of the fact packet then was, if they see 350 people a week, and if that was introduced over a 35 or 40 week period, you're looking at those skills being picked up somewhere between 12 and 14,000 people. I think that's something that is easily achievable given the facilities that they have. And I'm just wondering whether or not you could take that back and perhaps consider that as part of the review within that partner agreement. Thanks.
I mean, that's a really, really good idea, and I'm sure that the department will build that into the partner agreements.
Thank you very much.
Councillor Leech.
Thanks, Chair. I'd like to support this request for financial services. As Janette said, the work that Tranmere do within the community is vital for some people. Over the weekend, I've actually collected toys from them, which their fans and the club have got together for donations for young people who would otherwise go without toys over Christmas. And they had realised that within my own ward at Lisa that we were doing 67 hampers for people who regularly attend food banks. And these toys will go to support the hampers as well. And so, you know, the work that they do in the community is absolutely phenomenal.
Councillor Lewis,
any other
comments? I think if you look at page 16, as Councillor Jones said, I think it shows the length and breadth of what Tranmere do on behalf of the community across all sectors, working in partnership both with this council. It helps the council with its priorities of delivery and on behalf of the people, on behalf of the people we represent. Like the services, this gives a great value for money working in partnership with ourselves. And I think I'm right to say I don't have the scrutiny committee meeting, but Mark Collins came along the scrutiny committee. Reception from all parties, both cross-party reception. So I'd like to can we endorse the recommendation of our proposal? Okay, second. Can we agree?
Agree.
Thank you very much indeed. Okay, at this point I'd like to move the exemption, exclusion of the press and public, just for this last item, please. To read it out, sorry. Recommendation that under section 100A4 of the Local Government Act 1972, the public be excluded from the meeting during consideration of following items of business on grounds that they involve a likely disclosure of exempt information